Listen, that's when you go into the doctor. The doctor says, I cannot help you unless you tell me where it hurts. If you go in for surgery, says everything's okay, he says, and your appendix is bursting and you're holding on and you're sweating, the doctor says, I cannot help you unless you tell me where it hurts. And Jesus cannot deliver you unless you own up to you need deliverance.
Welcome to Higher Praise.
Yeah. The Lord is a good God. Worthy to be praised. Put your hands together and say, Jesus. Move upon us. Holy Spirit, we ask you, God, in the midst of your sanctuary and your people, that you would come down and you would just fix those broken things in our lives. Amen. How people know that you the clay and he's the potter. Some of you have been on that wheel all week long. Everything's spinning around and you feel like you want to get off. But the master's not done with you yet. Come on, see now he's spinning and he's fixing things for your good and his glory. So when people see you, they said, oh, she or he was a crackpot. But next time they see you, they see you restored. And God does it for his glory, because when they ask you, how did you get up out of that muck and mire? How did you change your life? Then you say, Jesus, the master, stepped in. And he does what he does. Turn to your neighbor and say, it's a Jesus thing. It's a Jesus thing. He loves fixing things. He loves fixing things. And I don't know what you came in from the outside to the inside, but you're not here on accident. Come on. You're here on purpose. Now listen, it's not just you're here on purpose. You're here on a purpose. God has a purpose for you, and you have a purpose to fulfill. Amen. It's crazy things going on, but you know, all the crazy things going on in the world can't compare to Jesus' crazy love that he has for each and every one of us. Crazy love. You know, there's something in the house where we always... heard one brother say this, you know, always be ready so you ain't got to get ready. And this has nothing to do with what I'm going to talk about, but this is something somebody needs to hear. Now, I know that when my wife was pregnant with our first child, our son, and it got to the last trimester and we're getting ready, and women know this, and they always have a bag packed. You always have your stuff ready. You have a bag packed. So you're not really sure when your water will break, whatever, because when it's time for delivery, you ain't got to get ready. You already ready. So when the baby, my wife said, he's about to come. I said, all right. So what we did, I knew where the bag was. So I grabbed the bag and we got in the car and had everything that she needed, because she was about to give birth to a new thing. Amen. I got some saints that's going to follow me for a minute. Some of you are spending too much time getting ready. You need to be ready. So if God calls you to do a new thing, are you going to try to go back and pack and get everything you need? Or are you going to be ready when God calls you? Some of you are pregnant with a vision but ain't packed yet. Amen. Some of you, God gave a word, but you ain't ready to give it yet. Because I want to tell you, you need to be ready for when God moves. Okay, listen. You asking for God for a new thing, but you ain't got rid of the old thing. Okay. You got to understand, you got to move the old junk to give room for the new stuff. Listen, I just want to say this real quick. You turn the light for me. Turn the light for me. I'm going to say this real quick. Why you holding on to old junk is occupying your space. There's no room for your future. Absolutely. Now, if I got my garage full and I'm going to try to get something else in the future, I can't fit anything in my garage from the future because I'm holding on to everything from the past. If you want to make room for your future, you got to let yesterday go. I know you messed up. I know you sinned. I know they talked about you. I know things didn't go the way you want to go. But listen, you can't keep chasing your future through the lens of your past. I don't know who that's for. That's a word for somebody. Some of you like your past because it gets you sympathy. It gets you a pass for your bad behavior or your attitude. But as soon as, and you get offended when people say, baby, you got to let that go. You don't understand. Yes, I do. Let it go. I'm tired of hearing about it. You come up talking about how you a new creature in Christ, but all I hear is old things from your mouth. Amen. This adult church, we just say like we're going to say, amen. Before I get started, I'm going to go ahead and release kids for children's church because y'all get me all tied up. Get me all tied up, bound up, and I can't do what I'm going to be doing and everything. Want the kids walking up on me afterwards like, why didn't we have Sunday school? Amen. Praise the Lord. Good to see you. If you're visiting for the first time, thank you so much for visiting with us. We really do appreciate you being here. We don't take it lightly. Amen. We have a lot of new things happening and going on. We're very excited about and we want you to be a part of. And we hope that you would relax. Let the Holy Spirit through the next 35, 45 minutes, let the Holy Spirit just marinate on you today. Amen. Amen. And I beg you and I ask you that you would look past me. And see what the Spirit of God is trying to deliver. Amen. Because even though I pastors preach to you, we have, like Paul says, I have not yet, apprehended all the things. But I'm constantly chasing and running after Christ. And I am totally 100% consumed by his call. Amen. And so I can see how because God had me speak in a certain direction today, and I could see how the Spirit was moving in the church today. I said, "Oh, okay, God, I see why we're going this direction." God's so faithful and good. And a couple things I want to point out in the scriptures that I'm going to be reading to you today, and I want to point out some things that you maybe have not really taken away from this telling of this story in the Bible, and have you, because I could come back and do like a 7-8-part series just on this section. And don't worry, I ain't doing that today. But I hope to give you enough to break the chain that binds you. I want you to hear me. All chains don't rattle. And all cages don't have walls. Some of us are captivated and chained in our minds. Some of you, I've seen the cages that you put yourself in. You think it's not a cage because you hang up artwork and you got a couch. But you stayed up bound. You just comfortable being bound. Amen. I'm gonna show you about two things we do here at Higher Praise. Everyone repeat after me, say amen.
Amen.
Totally acceptable. Everybody say this after me. Ouch.
Ouch.
Totally acceptable. Yes. And they both should go hand in hand to free us. So the title, I'm gonna give you the title first. The title of what I'm gonna be speaking to you today, what God has put on my heart, is drinking from the wrong well. Drinking from the wrong well. Amen. And so we have this, and a lot of us don't realize it. We make provisions. We don't even know a good help. We make provisions to do wrong, thinking that there's no other option. Amen. So before I go, I want to shed some backstory for sake of time, so I'm not reading you a bunch of scriptures and set it up. And I want to give you a little background about the Jews and the Samaritans, if I can. Okay, they did not get along at all.
Man, that's right.
You You know, the land of Judea was conquered, and the people sat behind. But the Samaritans have a connection to Jewish roots. But Samaritans only really practices the first five books of the Hebrew Bible. The rest of it didn't. And then when people kept coming through of the next 100 some years, whatever, kept coming through, the Samaritans would marry with the other people who are coming in. The Jews didn't like it. Who are the people that would coming in? So in the time when Jesus came, the Samaritans had a form of Judaism mixed with other superstitions. Okay? And they were like a mongrel faith. And if you want to look what that looks like in modern day, you could go down to like New Orleans. They'll mix voodoo with Catholicism. And other things. So you got people do it. So it was they had a mixture of faith, and the Jews disliked the Samaritans more than they did the Gentiles. Because they were so close to them that it would be confusing on me. And they would practice and in Samaria was a thing where Isaac dug a well and gave, and it was Jacob's inheritance, and the city was made around Jacob's well, right? And to let you know how much the Jews did not like the Samaritans, that if they had to go from Jerusalem to Galilee, they would go the long way to avoid going through Samaria. They would avoid them, okay? Because a lot of Samaritans were, you know, Jewish and something else, because they married with all the other groups that came in, and they would adopt certain things from the certain religions. So they had, you know, and they didn't really, only the first five or six books of the Hebrew Bible, and the rest of it they really didn't pay any attention to. And it just infuriated the Jews. Now, some of the more modern Jews would kind of come through Samaria, but ain't nobody hanging out there, right? So there was a total hatred for the Samaritans from the Jews, and the Samaritans didn't really care that much for the Jews either. There was a healthy dose of distrust between the two. They had certain places that they would worship. When you hear me reading, they'll talk about the Jews say we need to worship here, but we worship up there. And they built a place on the mountain where they were going to worship. Well, the Jews got it and burned it down and tore it down. So there was no love loss between the Samaritans and the Jews. The Jews are very pious, very rigid, very works oriented, and there was no tolerance for anybody out. They didn't, and Jews at the time, they weren't worried about converting people. They were praying the Sanhedrin and all them and the Sadducees and Pharisees, the ones that believed in the resurrection, would pray that Samaritans wouldn't be resurrected. Check it out. They didn't want them in the same kingdom of heaven that they were going in. Right? Yeah, someone's saying that's some gangster hate right there, right? So go to John, the sixth chapter, in fourth chapter, verse six, I'm sorry. And while you're doing that, I want everybody to say after me, say, God, show me me in the scripture. All right. Right here, we try to read scripture and figure out how we apply it to ourselves. So when I go through this, don't say this is good scripture for my friend or somebody else. Look at it as if it's you. Okay. And then that's how we grow. All right. And if that offends you, then you need to go back, look at all the scriptures like you're talking about you, because you got issues, okay? All right. Starting at verse 6 says, now Jacob's well was there. Jesus, therefore, being wearied from his journey, sat thus by the well. It was about the sixth hour. Now, we look at it, it's about 12 o'clock. It was the high noon. It was hot. Now, it was Jesus' idea not to go around, because he had to get to Galilee, so he wasn't going to go around Samaria. He went through. All right? And then he sat at the well because he was tired. Now, this is one thing about God. Jesus was fully God and fully man. He was tempted like all of us was tempted, and his flesh got tired like everybody else's flesh got tired. Jesus did not come down here in a body like Superman, like he couldn't get cut, because he got nailed and he got cut. So he humbled himself to be at the level of his creation so you could relate, so he could, we could relate to each other. Jesus desperately wants you to know him. And you desperately need to know him. Okay? So his disciples go into the city. They go to get some food and everything. And it's hot, and he's leaning by the thing in this. And let me go to verse 7 for explain this. And a woman of Samaria came to draw water. Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink." For his disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. Then the woman of Samaria said to him, "How is it that you, being a Jew, ask a drink from me, a Samaritan woman?" See, now you got to understand how, hey, it's like, you know, I don't know, if there's somebody that you dislike, listen, don't eat their cooking, because, you know, they might spit in your stuff. You know what I'm saying? Someone you don't like, I'm like, how you, you got some nerve asking me, you know, you got some nerve asking me for extra piece of chicken. We don't even like each other, you know. I ain't never seen extra pieces of chicken in my house, but you know what I'm saying. But listen, y'all got me messed up. And for Jews have no dealing with the Samaritans. Jesus answered and said to her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is who says to you, 'Give me to drink,' you would have asked him, and he would have given you living waters." The woman said to him, "Sir, you have nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. Where then do you get that living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us this well and drank from it himself, as well as his son and his livestock?" Jesus answered and said to her, "Whoever drinks of this water will thirst again, but whoever drinks of this water that I shall give him will never thirst, but the water that I shall give him will become a fountain in him of water springing up into everlasting life." Now, I got some more to read, but I'm going to go back and I'm going to say something. Now, see, you know, there used to be an adjective where we're in if you were in an office building and they would say, "Hey, you know, have you heard the latest rumor in about the business in the office?" And you say, "Well, this is what I heard around the water cooler." Yeah. You heard anything, you know, they talk about it around the water cooler. Well, see, the thing about it is that back during that time, women usually would go to the well early in the cool of the day. So they're thinking, and this is what they would do to socialize. And if a man wanted to get his new wife or something like that, he would hang out around the well, right? You know what I mean? Where did Moses find his first wife at? And they would hang out around the well because the women would do that. But this woman was by herself, so that she may have been an outcast or pushed back because she went at a very hot and grueling time and she was by herself. Usually it's not that way. Usually there's an accompaniment of them, or they're escorted with people or something. But she went to go draw at the well at this time, showing that, you know, maybe her own people, you know, the Jews didn't like her, and maybe her own people didn't trust her or didn't care for her either. But this is who Jesus is speaking to at this well, and who he's talking to her about this living water. And the ancient term living water sometimes would apply to like a spring that bubbles up out, spring water that bubbles up, and they would call it living or active water. And you had to make sure that she at first wasn't confusing living water with like, "Oh, you know, another well where I don't have to do this." But what the woman didn't know is that she was standing in front of two wells. Two wells. And he's trying to show her that a lot of us stand at the edge of a choice. Make sure you're not choosing the wrong well. And then verse 15. The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water that I may not thirst nor come here to draw." She figured, okay, you're going to make my life easier. I ain't got to come here in the middle of the day. Yeah, just give me this water. I ain't got to come here. Jesus said to her, "Go call your husband and come here." Now, Jesus did that because that's proper. Jesus would follow all the things to do unless, and if he didn't follow the customs, they knew that he had a reason because the custom went against the word. So it was customary for him to say, come. See, because Jews, the more Orthodox Jews, a lot of times won't even talk to their sister or have a conversation with the sister and the wife in public. And they sure enough wouldn't go up and talk to another strange woman in public. That would be seen as just not proper. So to know, and I don't know if anybody else saw anybody listening, he did what the proper thing. He says, now, it's not lawful for me to sit here and talk with you if you're married. So bring your husband so you know what we're talking about, what we're doing. And the woman answered and said, "I have no husband." Jesus said to her, "You have well said, I have no husband, for you have had five husbands, and the one whom you now have is not your husband. In that, you spoke truly." Now, it's a good thing she spoke truly. I'm going to tell you right. This is another verse that comes to show you that Jesus does not consider you living with a man as being married. Don't hate me. I'm just saying, do you? Why do Jesus? Jesus showed it clearly that you said, right, this is not your husband. This is the man you have next to him. Now, listen, I don't know what happened. I don't know if these five jokers died, if they put her out. I don't know. She had five. She's on six now. I think the sixth one saw what happened to the last five and said, oh, we just hanging out. I don't know. But Jesus was commending her truthfulness. Listen, don't be at the preface. Don't be at the edge of the well and keep lying. How can you get delivered from your situation if you can't be truthful who you want to deliver you? Listen, that's when you go into the doctor. The doctor says, I cannot help you unless you tell me where it hurts. If you go in for surgery, says everything's okay, he says, and your appendix is bursting and you're holding on and you're sweating, the doctor says, I cannot help you unless you tell me where it hurts. And Jesus cannot deliver you unless you own up to you need deliverance. Listen, everybody in here, before y'all get mad, everybody here, you nice people. You're nice people. Everybody's friendly. You know, we hug each other, we shake. I ain't saying you're nice, but you may not be saved. Amen. You know, they got a section in hell. I said, what's that section? Nice people. They're in agony going, oh my God, it burns. Excuse me. Oh my God. Oh, excuse me. You know, they're all nice and think, but that's not why Jesus didn't die to give you better manners. He died to give you a better life. Woo! Amen. So let's be for real about it. Yeah, amen. Let's just talk about it. Let's just be just out front. You know, and this is the thing, you know, we say this thing, it says, dude, I'm so blessed, I'm not where I need to be, but at least I'm not what I am. What that say? That's a fancy way of saying you stuck in the middle. When you say that, I'm saying, but you on the journey to get to where you need to be, right? Don't think you get brownie points by saying I'm not what I used to be, but I'm not what I'm supposed to be. Dude, you stuck in the middle. Ain't no joy stuck in the middle. That's like being in the middle of a race and everybody keep lapping you because you're just in the middle of the track. Either run it or get off the track. Amen. Quit living your life. See, that's why somebody's like, oh, I need to change. I'm stuck. Yeah, you're stuck right in the middle. And you make excuses to why you won't go with Jesus all the way. Well, you just don't understand. No, the problem is the only person who doesn't understand when you say it is the person who says you don't understand. Because the people who are trying to point it out totally understand that you're stuck. But you rather complain about being stuck than actually get unstuck. Because when you say you're stuck, people bring you. So what bring you food? You all right, sister? You need anything? I'm going to pray for whatever. Yeah, I'm making it and pray for you. And you come back next week, you're same place. And you go, dude, when is going to be a time where you're going to be the giver instead of the receiver? I know some people who are professional receivers. And I don't mean football. They can get up here and testify about how many times God has given them stuff, people have blessed them, whatever that is, but they can't testify of how much they did. Yeah. Whoa. Yeah, you know, it's like, you know, I feed the homeless, God spoke to me and I prayed for this person, God spoke to me and I cut this person's grass. No, they're usually the receiver of all that, but they can't get up and tell you one thing they did for anybody else. That's a professional receiver, don't feed into that. Don't feed into professional receiver. And if you are a professional receiver, put in your notice and quit that job and get on the job where you do. For Christ. You can do that. You can do that. Even if it's making phone calls, people get mad. Ain't nobody called me. And I ask, well, who'd you call? Nobody. Well, what you complaining about? This is a two-way walkie-talkie right here. Does your phone got numbers? Yeah, dial somebody. Quit making people in the church try to read your mind. Try to osmosis. We don't do tarot cards up here, so we ain't running your cards unless you call. Come on. Ain't nobody care about me. Oh, suck it up. Suck it up. Jesus guaranteed you eternal life. He did not guarantee everybody gonna like you. He did not guarantee everybody gonna like you. Ask the apostles. He ain't not going to guarantee everybody like you. But God says, I love you. So he gets to the woman and says she spoke truly. And we look at verse 19. And the woman said to him, sir, I perceive. Everybody said, duh. Okay, you know, I perceive that you are a prophet. Our father. And then she changed from the situation about the man she lived with. Then she put the situation back on worship. And she says, our fathers worshipped on this mountain. And you Jews say that in Jerusalem is a place where one ought to worship. Jesus said to her, woman, believe me, the hour is coming when you will neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem worship the Father. And then he went back and he is on the side of the Jews. Basically chastising them for how they believe, because this is what he says in 22, you worship what you do not know. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews, but the hour is coming now is, because he is the beginning of the church, listen, when true worshipers will worship the Father in what? Spirit and in truth. Now listen to this. True worshipers worship God in spirit and in truth. Now go back up to verse 20. Go back to verse 20. And it says, our fathers worshiped on this mountain, and the Jews say that you worship in Jerusalem. Jesus just told her, worship is not a place. Worship is spirit and truth. So there comes a time where you're not going to worship on this mountain and you're not going to worship in Jerusalem, but what you are going to worship is in spirit and in truth. That's all the places that you worship. Now listen, we'll make any rock sacred. They thought Jacob's well was sacred. It was a blessing because the well was a form of life-giving, because that's why the Holy Spirit can also be synonymous with water or movement. That's why a whale, they usually build cities around a whale. Because that's what the water is. That's life. But listen, side by side two wells, one was temporal life and one was everlasting life. Two wells. One for earthly life, and the one set next to it was for eternal life. Do you know that you guys are at the well every day? And you can either choose death or life. And if you knew who gave life, you would ask him for a drink daily. If you knew. But we're in this, and he's talking about, you know, we worship in spirit and in truth. Going back down to 24, but the Father is seeking such to worship him. In verse 24, God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship him in what? Spirit and truth. All right? So you cannot get your feel off of the natural and just please God. Amen. Okay, you know, our body, I got some nurses here that they'll correct me, whatever, but I know it's over. Our body is over like 90% water, right? And dehydration will put you in the hospital. It'll shut down your internal organs, everything else like this. Some of you are spiritually dehydrated, and you still cater to the flesh thinking it's going to fix your heart. So you keep feeding the flesh, and that's not the issue on the inside. It's what's starving. And we complain because then we want to put on a new event so you can have a moment of happiness. Remember, happy is rooted in happenings. So you get happy when something's happening. But joy is peace sitting on your porch and ain't nothing going on. Joy and happiness are two different things. Happiness is temporary. Happiness is temporary. Joy is something about peace, love, and goes into eternity. I choose joy. Yes. Come on, somebody. Because one song is going to be the DJ's last song. And your party, and you're going to have to go home sometime. Whether you're staggering or you're in somebody else's house throwing up, but I don't care what party you go to, one song is going to be the last song. This is the last song. The bar will close. This is the last call. And all your happy happenings is over. Then reality comes back in, your head's throbbing, and then you're mad, and then you swear that you're never going to do it again. Then your spirit is so sunk down, you figure, well, maybe this is all I know. So you go back to the natural well. And like Sister said, you don't realize, and then 10 years has gone past. And I like it when Denzel Washington said this is, do not mistake motion, forward motion with progress. They're two different things. You can run on a treadmill and never go nowhere. Motion without progress. Amen. We have a lot of saints who go through a lot of motions, but no progress. Listen, have you ever went up to some person, you ask, you know, they're really good people, and they love, you know, they say they love the Lord over, and then you want to ask, he says, look, I ain't trying to be judgmental, I'm asking because I want to know, how come Jesus is not enough for you? How come he's not enough? You know, and I've asked some people, and I just really want to know, because different people have different things. I said, because it's always Jesus, and you always got to have something else. And you lean on, well, you know, I know I believe, but I'm, you know, I believe and stuff like this, but, you know, I'll shut a party down. But then you ask, okay, that's cool, you know, all right, that's fine, do what you want to do. But how come he's not enough? You know, and that's because you haven't drank from him lately. And you're still thirsty. Because why Jesus said, if you drink of this water, you'll never thirst again. Because he says the Spirit lives up in you and it spews out a well. And you start producing water within yourself. Here, let me before I come back to this scripture, let's go to another scripture real quick. Let's go to Jeremiah. Jeremiah, the second chapter, verse 13. And there's more, but for a second time, I just did this one. Verse 13 says, "For my people have committed two evils. They have forsaken me, the fountain of living water, and hewn themselves cisterns, broken cisterns that can hold no water." That's what Jesus is talking about. I am the living water. Quote some of these scriptures from Jeremiah. It says, there are two evils. They have forsaken the living water, and you try to produce it yourself. It says, my people are condemned for two evils. So we think, like, you know, I remember we had this thing. You ever had those people? They see back in my day, they did that. But you know, a lot of the young ladies don't cook now. Don't throw things on me. I'm just saying. I know y'all busy, because I know y'all get hateful when I talk about y'all ain't cooking. But anyway. But back in my day, if you was a kid and you complained and you wanted something, mama go, "We ain't gotta buy that. I make that at home." Like, but mama, I don't want. What you mean? I want the Happy Meal. I make you one of them at home, baby. I make you one of them at home. You put the pan, make your own thing. You're like, but that's not like Ronald McDonald. That's not the thing. He said, "Mom, I want some Dunkin' Donuts. Dunkin' Donuts, we don't need Dunkin'. I make your own donuts. Give me some biscuits." "But Mama, I want the yeast donuts." "Don't worry, these just as good." "But Mom, these ain't like Dunkin' Donuts." You know, or you're like, we don't need to go to the mechanic with a car. We don't need to go to the mechanic. Give me that duct tape. Duct tape and pantyhose. We got that, but I don't think we're like, we don't need no mechanic, you know. That's what we do. Instead of going and getting from Jesus the original, we think we can make it ourselves. And it's gonna be the exact same thing. You don't need no savior. I'm the one that saved you. Dude, I can't even get you when I text you half time. How you gonna save me? You don't need nobody. I got this all figured out. Dude, what do you mean you got you figured out? Took you 10 times to pass the driving test. How you got life figured out? No, I'm just giving you some examples of how we think. You know, we think we've conquered. Amen. Have you always noticed, and maybe this is just me, have you always noticed that the most broke person in your group is the first person to give you financial advice? You know, your buddy who never chip in on gas, when you're in the world, he drink your last beer, you almost fight. Think he entitled to the last piece of pizza and didn't chip in. Using your fingernail polish, your blouse, everything, but always want to give you advice. Now, if that was me, this is what I would do. Dude, if you would do something, you have something. Yeah. Amen? And it's funny how we have Christians who always will go to the world to fix a spiritual problem. The Bible says, do not sit in the way of stand in the way of sinners or sit in the seat of the scornful. You know, and they're just complaining about church. And I ain't never seen so many people complain about going to church. It's just crazy. Even say people. And they'll say, "Now, this is what you want to do when you want to shut your friends down. Ask them, make them tell you, I'm saved. You ain't got to go to church to be saved." And I go, "Well, why don't you want to go?" That's like saying, I'm a fisherman, but I don't go fishing. I'm a gym rat, but I don't go to the gym. So you don't have to go to church to be saved, but you have to go to church to be effective. You know? And so people act like we invented church. We didn't invent church, God did. It's in the Bible. You know, it's so funny how Jesus went to the synagogue, but you justify how you can't go to, okay. Jesus did it. But you want to tell Jesus, I'm a little bit better than Jesus. You know, Jesus got issues. I got mine figured out. Me, you ever heard this? Me and God got an understanding. Like Jesus and the Father didn't. He was there.
Yeah, amen.
Jesus got thrown out of services. Jesus was so committed to go, now I know y'all like this, that his family lost him on the way home from the census.
Yeah, yeah.
They looked around, it's a big caravan. They looked around and they said, where is Yeshua? Where's Jesus? I said, I don't know. They had to walk, what, 1 or 2 days back and looked all over to find him and found him in the synagogue teaching as a teenager. And it says, we looked all over for you. And he said, why? I would be in my Father's house. You should know that. But I don't know about you, but if I was marrying Joseph, there's a deep place in hell for losing Jesus. I'm just saying. You had one job. You had one job to watch baby Jesus. That's all you had to do. One job. I guarantee, you know why it took them so long to find Jesus 2 days? They didn't pray for 2 days. They go, don't talk to him. Shh. The Lord help us. No, if we pray to him, he gonna know we lost him. We got to just look. He said, like, Jehovah God, he's like, no, don't say it. But the family of Jesus says, I'm in my Father's house. So when you're a Christian, you justify that being a father. Why? I mean, you better than the Savior? Because there's so much we can do together that we can't do alone. You better than Jesus. Jesus did alone. Jesus went out and got 12 other dudes to spread the gospel. But you can do everything by yourself. Have we learned anything? Let me go back to my original text so I can wind this up before y'all walk out on me. Amen. I'm going to get a spotlight on church where every time I walk up, I'm going to look at you. Okay? And so he's talking about the water and the truth of the worship. And he's talking to a Samaritan woman who was really surprised that he wouldn't even talk to him. And this is what I want to show you. Jesus reaches low. Jesus reaches low, and I'm going to tell you why. In all the dealings, if Jesus would have went to the most noble person in Samaria and spoke with him and talked with him, oh, you wouldn't get the idea that everyone can come to Jesus because, oh, well, sure, you know, they're nobility, they're different. Oh, sure, they're rich. And just what Jesus says, I'm no respect of place or person. Listen, place or person. The places that you make holy ain't nothing to Jesus. Listen, a holy place cannot be more holier than the Holy One. So Jesus is not impressed where the burning bush was. Jesus is not impressed where he parted the waters. Because his holy miracles came from his holiness. And he is not impressed by something that he did him. Okay. But listen, y'all will bid $1,000 for a piece of toast in Vegas that looked like Jesus. It's the Virgin Mary on the other side too. Man, it does look like her. Regular toast. What is it? Is that multi-grain or is that bleached wheat? What is that? We'll make anything an idol. That's why Jesus purposely didn't baptize anyone himself, because you would have saw who Jesus baptizes better. But it showed the difference between him and John the Baptist. John the Baptist baptized, but Jesus didn't, because he was elevated. Who John says, whose shoes are not even worthy to loosen. So you know how we do, and there's certain names and certain things. Now the woman at the well, her name was never mentioned. But her situation was. And the deliverance and stuff that happened at the well, Jesus put in there about her husband's, because he shows that he confronted her sin before he gave her the drink. She was truthful about her sin, and he says, this is the living water. Now, what's so crazy was that she immediately turned into evangelism. When the other apostles came back, it got kind of awkward, right? So she's looking, so she leaves. They know she's coming back because she left what she was drawing the water from right next to him at the well. So they knew she was coming back, because that ain't something you leave behind, because you got to have water to live. So she left what she left behind, right? She comes back. She goes, listen, this is so great. I'm almost done. Really, this is so great. She goes back and testifies and puts her life, says, go listen to the man who has told me everything I've done. Could this be the Messiah? They come back and they look and they say and they beg Jesus to stay. So Jesus stays 2 days in Samaria. You see, this is a big deal, because they wouldn't want to pass by, let alone stay a couple nights. Stayed a couple nights, and the man says, now we don't just believe because you told us. We believe because we've seen him. We believe because we had an experience. We came because you told us. We had an experience, and now we believe. Amen. So to wind this up, I'll do it the way that I started is, you're at two wells. Right now, how does this apply to your life? You're at two wells right now. You can keep doing what you got and keep drinking and come back the next day and just keep drinking. Or you can have eternal life and have a well within you. See, the Holy Spirit springs up a well. See, listen, it's like this. You remember when you had to, see, I'm dating myself. You remember when you had to leave your phone at home? Oh, yeah. Amen. See, Doug still does. So I can't catch Doug unless he's in the house. But Doug's phone's on the house. But now you can take your phone with you. That's like the Holy Spirit. Used to be you had to go to a certain place to visit and get the Holy Spirit. This time now it's with you. And now it's like having your own well. It's like having your own bottle of water with you. You have your own well with you. And it's always with you. And you can never go to the bottom of it, because Jesus keeps filling it back up. And you go to service and he fills you back up on Wednesday. He fills you up in Bible study. He fills you up on Sunday. Then you come back, you drink, you come back, he keeps filling you up. He keeps filling you up. That's the well. But listen, some of you are so parched and empty because you refuse. Okay. When we don't do that, and then we can become a parasite, where you're asking everybody else to give you a sip instead of having your own water, like the 10 virgins. Give me some of your oil. They said, no, go get your own. Because why in the world should I give you a drink from my bottle when there's a fountain right there? I'm like, dude, there's a fountain right there. Get your own water. No, I want yours. It's better. No, get your own. And what we do is we make people codependent. And we become enablers, because we get satisfaction of them drinking from our well. Oh, yeah, my water's better than them. And we get this sick satisfaction of having people depend upon us. That's not biblical. Plus, it drains you. The person never sees Jesus. All they do is see you. And it's a cycle of you trying to build your own kingdom. Please stop. There's enough water for everyone at the well. Now, we're going to talk and real sins. We do some ugly things in the world and cheat, lie, fornicate, we abuse, I haven't seen anything in the world that a human can't abuse, whatever it is. If you don't know the use of something, then abuse is inevitable. I've seen people even abuse screwdrivers. There's so many screwdrivers in the world that have been used as hammers because they don't want to go get a hammer. Bam, bam, bam. Dude, you know that's not a hammer. Yeah, but it'll work. You cannot pick a thing that I haven't seen people abuse. We abuse relationships. You didn't even abuse your car. Y'all doing stuff with your car that it wasn't designed to do. You know, I've seen a little compact car that have a dresser, a bed, and a mattress, and everything roped on top of it like it was a big semi-truck. We would abuse anything. Amen. Y'all know I ain't lying. We abuse anything. But once you get in that cycle of abuse, you assume that's life. But God died that you could have eternal life and be born again. There's no place Jesus won't go to get you. I've heard stories of people saying, I seen Jesus when I was up in the crack house. And I was crying out to him, and he appeared to me, and he led me. See, there's no place Jesus won't go to get you. Amen. Ask Paul and Silas when they were up in the jail. See, listen. He went up in the jail. The jail was going to kill himself, but everybody says, no, we're here. See, Jesus will set you free, the anointing to keep you. Someone today, you know this is your day. Listen, you have not been fighting with the devil this week. You've been fighting with yourself. The devil would love to get all the credit for all the hardship that you went through. But a lot of your hardship is you. Okay, don't get mad at me. I got my own. I do. But right now, in the name of Jesus, I pray that the Holy Spirit will set you free. Come on, Jesus. That the Holy Spirit would set you free. Chains would start to fall off your mind. Right now, in the name of Jesus. Everyone would repeat after me, say, God, set me free. I give you permission to come into the dark places of my heart and set me free today. In Jesus' name. I ask everybody to stand all over the building. Now listen, if you prayed that and you meant it, and this is the first time, get my prayer partners to come up here. Whoever's going to come up here, I don't care. Just fall in real quick. And you said, this is the first time I ever said, Jesus, come into my life. And if that's you, amen. If that's you, just raise your hand if that's you, just where you are. If that's the first time that you ever prayed for Jesus to come into your life, is anybody in the house? Anybody in the house? Second, if you're saying, you know what, Pastor, I get you. I've been on this backsliding trip. I walked back on God, but I ain't walking back on God anymore. I'm gonna open up my heart and give my heart back to Jesus. If that's you, listen. Now you can come to the altar, come to one of his prayer partners, say, brother or sister, I need my life to change. Pray I have a new heart, and we're gonna pray for you. If you want to kneel at the own altar and pray, you can. If you have a friend with you and maybe they're nervous, but they want their life to change, walk with them. Say, I walk with you as you give your life to Christ. You have two wells, one's living water today. And if you leave out of here and don't give your life to Christ, there's no one to blame. You can't blame the abuse of your daddy or your mama. You can't blame that they fired you on your job. You can't blame that you had a hard life. Because Jesus right now is accepting you of who you are and where you are. Well, I don't come because I had a bad experience with some person at church. Well, that person at church wasn't Jesus. I'm calling you not to me or not to, I'm calling you to Jesus. And if you know that you're lost today, if you know that you would not go to heaven, if you die today, this altar call is for you. Listen, 51% don't get you into heaven. 100% of Jesus gets you into heaven. Amen. If you do not have that rested assurance that heaven is your home. Quit playing. Quit playing. And come receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. The altar is open all over as they sing and play, "You Come." Altar's open. Hello, everyone. For everyone who loves to donate to Higher Praise Worship Center, we have a new text to give number. The text to give number is 888-364-4483. And then you text HPWC812. HPWC812. And it will prompt you how to give. God bless and thank you.